They're the first generation to be fully born in the 21st century, and the oldest of them began being born in the year 2010, which was the same year that Instagram and the iPad both launched. Yes, we're talking about Generation Alpha, the generation born between 2010 and 2024. While the youngest of them are yet to be born, the oldest of them are about to become teenagers. So joining me to discuss this big shift into teendom is the demographer and futurist who gave this generation their name, Mark McCrindle. Mark, welcome back to the podcast.
Thanks, Ash. Good to be with you as always.
It's a pretty interesting topic. I feel like anytime anyone says the word like teenager, some people go, oh, the teens years, like get a bit scared. And we are talking about this because Generation Alpha, the oldest of them, will be becoming teenagers as of next year, which is a big step into this new life stage. What do you think about this life stage, Mark? Do you think it plays into the fact that it's increasingly relevant for us to be talking about this generation? Because sometimes we get the feedback that people are like, oh, it's too early to be talking about Alpha. We're still trying to get across Generation Z. But we know that future-focused organizations have been thinking about the Alphas for some time. Now the fact that they're hitting their teenage years, do you feel like that gives people a bit more encouragement to be thinking about this future generation?
Oh, yeah, we definitely need to be thinking about this generation at this particular life stage as they become teenagers because, big tech is thinking about them. They're just about to enter onto all of those platforms and marketers are thinking about them. The big brands are thinking about them. They see them as key consumers as they move into their technology and consumer life stage. And therefore, educators better be thinking about them and parents better be thinking about them and all of us in our society, you know, better have a good understanding of Generation Alpha as they hit the critical teenage life stage so that we can give them that important direction, support and input because it's such a different era to come of age. You know, if we think about the baby boomers and even us Gen Xers, you know, the technology that we engage with that was coming of age as we entered our teenage years, you know, for us Gen Xers, it was the video era. You'd watch videos together, the boom boxes had come out, you could listen to music together, but it was a shared experience with the peer group. Boomers before us, you know, maybe go to movies together and the radio was out and that came with an external speaker to listen together. And now we're in an era where not only is it internet and social media, and any streamed service, but it's communicated or engaged with on a personalized device on the smartphone. And so it's not designed to be shared communally with peers, but to be consumed individually. And we see that even with playing video games or, you know, posting something on TikTok, it's more done individually that experience takes place in. So, you know, from the social years of the teenagerhood being engaged in entertainment and the connection being a shared one to now that connection still being social, but being an individual one on a small screen or as someone posts, in their own individualized context. That's quite the transformed situation. Even though they're engaging with the latest technology and they're coming of age in that social life stage, it's a very different context today compared to what we've seen the previous teenagers connect with.
Yeah, it's absolutely very different. And I was just having a look before that I think it's 13 years of age, which makes it, I guess, legal or encouraged that kids or people can start to actually contribute on platforms like TikTok, like YouTube, like Instagram. Like technically, Generation Alpha so far shouldn't be on these platforms. But we know from the research we've conducted, particularly in speaking with parents and leaders, that they're still being impacted by the trends that are on these platforms, even though technically they're not really allowed to be on them yet. But now the oldest of them, as of sort of next year, can start to really be contributors to these platforms. So it'll be interesting to see as well how that voice and their world view and perspective is kind of starting to have a platform as well. It'll be interesting to see that evolve too.
Totally. And that's why it is such a crucial stage in our development, in the human journey. Because prior to the teenage years, we're totally dependent. The childhood is the dependence age. And the rules like that children can't be on social media or, you know, can't enter into a contract or vote or buy alcohol. Mm. I mean, all these things are important, right? So there's the dependence life stage, and they're prohibited from such things because we want to make sure that the adults are guiding and supporting and leading. And obviously the teenagerhood is a transition point to adulthood, which hits at 18 legally, in terms of independence, and they fully make their own decisions, and they can vote and start a company and open a bank account and marry and do whatever they choose to do. So this critical phase between the dependence of childhood and the independence of adulthood is this transitional point where adults, parents, families get to lead their teenager children through a stage where increasingly the youngsters have more of a voice and a say and some independence. It's this interdependence life stage. And if we don't take advantage of that opportunity that we have, if, in other words, they move straight from dependence to independence because we didn't utilize that time to guide and give a bit more space, give them the opportunity to make some decisions and to make some bad ones and to learn from the consequences of those decisions, give them a bit of space to head out on their own and map out a little bit of their own independence, then when they suddenly hit that age and they can do everything without any guidance or trial period, they will do anything and head anywhere, and the consequences won't be as positive as if we had taken the teenagerhood life stage to guide a little. So that's why it's so critical. And I think the challenge that we have in this era, and particularly around technology, is that in the past, this teenagerhood life stage was lived in an era where the experts, the authority figures, those giving the guidance and the input, well, there was no internet or TikTok to get the advice from. So it was mom and it was dad, and it was maybe a grandparent, a trusted uncle or auntie, maybe an older sibling, perhaps a leader in the community, someone running the youth development program, or a pastor at the church, a youth group leader, or maybe just a really trusted careers advisor, teacher, someone in their community gave that input. Now they're going to TikTok. They're getting the influencer out there to give that guidance, who not only is unverified because it hasn't come through the trusted family circles or authority structures, but they're probably unqualified as well. And so that can be a dangerous source of content, learning and information if it's all just through the social media and there's no filtering through the trusted people in their world. That's the extra challenge we have in the big tech context of today.
Yeah, and I know you're referencing there, Mark, some research we conducted earlier this year under our Education Future report, which was our annual study. And this year we did survey students aged 16 to 24, and we found the top three platforms that these students have for teaching themselves new skills on a daily basis is teachers at number one, websites at number two, and TikTok at number three. And TikTok only just coming in third, like percentage-wise, not that far behind the first two, which is... Yeah, it's so fascinating, even just the whole TikTok world and the algorithms. And we were talking about this, and we share with people our insight in the world we live in today, largely from technology, is that we've all got what we call expectation inflation, where we expect information to be more personalized, to be immediate, to be relevant. And even that whole personalized trend is quite interesting in this context, because even though we all expect personalization, and for these emerging generations, they'll expect personalized Spotify playlists and customized Netflix, recommendations. Interestingly, or ironically in some ways, like this, if they're getting advice from TikTok, that's not personalized. That's generic advice that these influencers with big influence and platforms and followers are giving advice maybe to younger generations, to hundreds and thousands or millions of them. Like, and I think you mentioned to me before, like the most personalized, customized advice is from the people that we know in our lives, our grandparents, our parents, who know us, who know our context. And even for me, like I consume things on TikTok, and sometimes I'll watch something and someone will be really inspiring and they'll share a quote or a piece of like advice about living in your 20s or your 30s. And I'm like, yeah. And then sometimes you see a counter argument and I'm like, no, actually don't think that. Like it can be really easy to fall into that trap for me and a fully fledged adult of taking advice from someone who's got influence or some great ideas, but it's never the same as someone who knows you and who knows your context. So exactly. Even for teenagers, like we've got to be careful of that for them.
Yeah, so true. And who is on your side, you know, is gunning for you and has been since you were a youngster, since you were born or since they first knew you. So they've got a real vested interest in seeing your best, which is not the case for some of these influencers that, let's face it, are being paid to promote that product or
Absolutely.
They're getting a cut of people who sign up to that program. So we need a bit more skepticism. And probably the extra challenge is not only the unverified, unqualified sources of advice. And on that list, you said, you know, TikTok number three, parents were number four. So down the list, only just ahead of YouTube, you know, as a place for information. The challenge as well is that we've brought up these young people in a world where we've given just a blank page as to what they can do, where they can head and who they can be. In fact, even more than that, a blank book. We've said, we don't want to predetermine anything for you. You know, in the past, it was difficult enough for teenagers saying, well, what job will I take or who will I marry? Now we're saying, well, even think about what gender you want to be or what your sexuality is or, you know, not just when you'll marry or whether you'll marry, but hey, you know, anything is an option for you. And it's hard enough to make the smaller decisions in life. Shall I choose this course or that? Let alone saying, you know what, you're totally undetermined. So anything you can choose and you can be. And so we haven't even equipped them with the big rocks in life, you know. And so that can be a little bit destabilizing as you head closer and closer to adulthood with more of the responsibilities and the consequences and the big decisions to come to sort of set them free on the ocean of life and to say, I don't want to sort of determine anything for you. So, you know, go for it. And we're backing you, but you know, you need to make the decisions. I think that without, and this used to be more the case, you know, young people were given more of a sense of a worldview or maybe that intergenerational family structure, that foundation. These are our values. This is what we believe. This is how we behave. You know, this is the honor or the character or the name that we carry forward as a family or as a in terms of our history or what we're about. Now we're saying, well, we don't want to, you know, predetermine any of that. So, you know, you be you. And that can be in some ways exciting, cool, I can head anywhere, but in other ways quite daunting. And it is, we get feedback constantly from educators that the one thing that they need, it's not just skills, you know, it's not just educational content, it's that character formation. It's having the resilience and the values and the clear direction, the purpose in terms of what they can be and why they're here. And sure, those decisions in terms of careers and roles and relationships, they will determine. But at least they've got a foundation as to their purpose and their value and their views, and they can nuance that as they go. We wrote in that book, actually, as you remember, on Generation Alpha, we said, you know, this is the options generation with unlimited choices, but we do them no favors to give them endless possibilities but no purpose. And that's a role for the parents and the experts and the supporters in their life to help direct them around purpose, around values, around character, around worldview, so that they can not face the anxiety of the total blank page, but can know where they fit, who they are, a sense of that value, and then make the more personal decisions around career and life and relationships based on that solid foundation.
Absolutely. It's a really helpful perspective, I think. And perspective to talk about because, yeah, I think on the surface it can very much seem like, yeah, this options generation with so many different pathways and life choices, you know, more choice equals good thing. Like in a very simplistic view, sometimes I think we can just assume that or think that, but actually there can be challenges that come with that as well. And we also wrote, I remember in the Generation Alpha book, that yes, Generation Alpha are different. They're definitely growing up in a different context with technology, but there's also timeless human needs that they need to have: love, belonging, a sense of identity, those foundational elements that still ring true even in the context that is shaping them is so different. So I think, yeah, for anyone listening, hopefully that is an encouragement to lead and to do that well and to steward that role you maybe have in a Generation Alpha's life well. Part of the conversation here that we talk about is also a term that we use and we wrote about in the Generation Alpha book that we've kind of coined around up-aging. And I wondered, Mark, if you could just give an explanation to this term, because we talk about it all the time, but maybe it's a new term to someone. What do you describe to people when you say Generation Alpha are up-agers?
It means that they're older, younger. So their chronological age is what it is, but their psychological age, maybe even their academic age, is beyond that. And so that just means, and teachers say it to us, you know, wow, the things a decade ago we were doing with the years fives and sixes, we're now doing with the years threes and fours. Partly that's just because the generation that has exposure to more things in this world earlier. So we've got to protect them and give them a bit more information to guide them earlier. Partly it's a sophisticated curriculum. And so through the learning tools and the technologies, they're advancing in a lot of ways in terms of what they're learning at younger years. So from a knowledge and an exposure perspective, they're older, younger. But in other ways, we might call them down ages. That is, they're actually younger, longer. They're actually maybe more naive than their years might suggest. And that is in areas perhaps like experience of life, because parents are keeping these children pretty contained. You know, it used to be that teenagers, even probably early teens, had a bit more freedom to maybe with friends, you know, ride their bikes, head out to play, hang out at friends' homes for much of the weekend. Perhaps, you know, catch a train into the city or catch public transport around, engage with their peers. Now that's less likely to be normative, and parents drop their children around. They pick them up. They'll drop them off at the friend's house. They'll pick them up straight after. The controls, the frameworks and the structures are far more detailed for teenagers today than we've seen in the past. And that means that they don't have as much of the freedom to make their own decisions, to develop those social skills, to even have knowledge of how to get around their city and make decisions when they're caught short and they're running low on money. They have to manage that, or they need to make a decision because they didn't know or weren't given exactly what to do in this particular circumstance. They've got an adult at that age, and that can be very healthy to stretch them, to grow them, to develop confidence and decision making abilities. So it's this dichotomy, really, that in a lot of ways they're older, younger, but in some ways they're more naive than teenagers past have been.
Yeah, that's a really interesting dichotomy, as you mentioned, and different lens, like it differs based on the lens that you overlay on this conversation in terms of, yes, they're academically maybe ahead of previous generations, but behind previous generations in terms of maybe some of those more practical life skills. And I even wonder if that is maybe something that is being passed down from millennial parents. Like, we're talking about my generation parenting the alphas, and I feel like not a lot of my friends know very many practical life skills, even like we're so used to outsourcing things or getting someone else to come in and do it. Whereas our grandparents were like, oh no, I can do all that. I'm a jack of all trades. I can do all these things. Whereas now, like even for me, it would outsource a bunch of things. Do I know how to change a tire? Admittedly, no, I don't. And like some of those life skills that even I don't know. So we're losing that from parents not passing it down, but also from the context shaping these alphas. And I know for me, I've got a family, older family member who is very heavily involved in scouts. And I hear a lot of stories about that from him, but also from research that we've done historically for organizations like scouts and Girl Guides who aren't getting the same sort of participation rates. And it's interesting to hear their reflections on it. Like they'll talk to parents of young people today and they're like, what do you mean my child's doing this crazy abseiling thing? That can't be safe. And they've got to go through, obviously, of course, they've got to go through all the safety things so it is as safe as possible. But even still, there's a lot of hesitance around children participating in some of those activities. And we talked about that in the Generation Alpha book as well, like the nature deficit disorder, that kids aren't spending even just as much time outside, let alone doing outdoor activities where they build resilience, where they test their limits, where they learn how to work as a team. So there are interesting ways to look at what skills Generation Alpha have and the positives, but also, I guess, the challenges that come with that too.
That's right. And sometimes even the sport, it's not just free sport where they're kicking a ball around with friends in the backyard or riding, getting up to adventures. It's structured sport, with an adult managing it all. And parents feel comfortable with that. And it does develop skills, but not in the same way as just the free range sports and activities. We want them to study hard. And so we say, well, maybe, don't get a part-time job, pour that time into study, or we don't have the time anyway because we've got the after-school tutoring. And so they're missing out on that, and yet learning a job, responding to a boss, engaging with customers, being able to connect across generations, shaking someone's hand, looking them in the eye, that customer service that you learn in those early jobs that the teenagers used to have as normative. And of course, managing the money that comes from that and having one's own responsibility to buy some of those clothes or to pay for one's own entertainment. That's the life skills. That's the character formation. That's preparing them for adulthood. And we've scratched a lot of that out as we've structured their lives a bit more, and let alone the outdoor skills, the life skills, the leadership skills that come from some of those activities and adventures, being able to camp out and manage risks, not in an unsafe way, but manage risks because life is full of risks, and assess that is a key stuff that we don't want to lose, and we're a bit more moving away from that as a society, and I think it's to the detriment of this generation of teenagers.
Yeah, they're definitely still going to need those skills that we talked about, even though maybe they're not getting exposed to them as much. So it's definitely something I think for us to keep in mind. Something else we often talk about with regards to defining this generation is that they're incredibly global. And we know that that comes from technology, but also demographically. We talked in a recent episode about the fact that our world's population has reached 8 billion and that a lot of the growth of that last billion has been in Asia. And we know that over half the alphas that we've added to our world are from Asia, born in Asia, especially within that India, China, and Indonesia being the top countries of birth. We often get asked about, for this global generation, do they differ based on where they live? Do they have different characteristics, alphas born in India compared to the United States or United States compared to Australia? What's your perspective, Mark, on that in terms of, are these children different based on where they live, even though they are so global?
Well, firstly, we've got to acknowledge that there's a lot of difference within this generation. And we, in our research, see a lot of the similarities. And that's remarkable to us to see how similar they are to each other and different across generations. But within a generation, of course, there's a lot of variety. In fact, every individual is different. And even within Australia or across states or in regions, you'll find difference. But what's remarkable to us in the analysis is how much connection there is and how much similarity there is even across these nations. And so certainly, again, there's going to be difference between a Gen Alpha teen in Bangkok, Thailand, and they'll be different from a Gen Alpha in Beijing, China. They'll be different from a youngster in Baltimore, US, or Brisbane, Australia. Of course, there's language differences, there's cultural differences, often religious or worldview differences. But here is the remarkable point and the takeaway. Each of those young people in those four cities is closer together than their parents and their grandparents ever were. So there is this sense of global convergence through the technologies that are shared platforms, through the devices, and these youngsters in each of these nations or any part of the world almost is going to have a smartphone. They're going to be connecting. They're online and LinkedIn and engaged. They have opportunities to connect with their peers in that way. The movies, the foods, the fashions, the music, the brands have gone global more than we've ever seen in the past. We know in Australia, it's the most culturally diverse generation. So they're connecting with people from Thailand or China or other parts of the world, even in the classroom, and let alone the global classroom through the technology. So they have more of a global awareness. They are tuned into global challenges. They recognize that their world is not the only world, but they are, of course, young people and all the generations right around this world, all from different contexts and cultures. And so they're tuned into that. And that means that there's this commonality. And whether it even be those global platforms of TikTok that we were discussing, or YouTube or Instagram or now the global gaming platforms they interact on. They could be playing with people, interacting or sharing input with their peers from so many different cultures that they may never meet, but they're connecting with through these global platforms. So far more global convergence, far more in common with this generation than any previous generation of teenagers in human history.
Yeah, and I feel like sometimes the way I approach answering this question is like if we were to do a big study of Generation Alphas in India compared to Australia, like of course there's going to be differences, there's going to be nuances, like you mentioned, for all those different reasons. But there's also going to be more similarities than ever before, and what influences them is going to be similar. They're all going to know probably the same viral trends and the same pop culture icons. And even as time changes, like the East influences the West, TikTok coming out of China there, like there's some big platforms there in terms of some shifts. But I've also reflect on it, you know, with you, Mark, and with other people as well, that we've conducted some international research on this generation, particularly in the United States. And it was amazing. We've conducted focus groups here in Australia, and then we conducted some groups over in the US as well. And it was amazing to see the issues on the hearts and the minds of the parents, and the trends were very similar, even across the other side of the world. And the presentations, like we get the privilege of traveling to places and delivering presentations about Generation Alpha, and you don't actually need to tweak all that much. Like, yes, we customize it, but the trends are there. They are global. So it's definitely something that we see. I'd love to circle back as well, Mark, just to thinking about parents, because particularly, as you mentioned, you know, part of the fact that Generation Alpha are now starting to enter the teenage years for the first time for this generation, parents play a big role in their life. But an interesting kind of shift happens when they start to enter those teenage years, as parents maybe ease off a little bit and help them start to transition into adulthood. How do you think Generation Alpha's parents differ to previous generations of parents?
Well, in a key way, and that is that they're far more involved and active in decision-making over the lives of their teenage children than we saw parents of teenagers in the past be. You know, it used to be parents were actively involved in the childhood years, but by the time the teen years come around, the youngsters hit high school, parents ease off a little. That's been the tradition. And I think there's been good reasons for that, because they want their children to develop their own social friendships, and they don't want to rescue the children all the time. They've wanted the children to make those decisions and learn through that experience. These days, though, there's such an intentionality, to give a positive spin to it, maybe there's such an anxiety and an obsession in the minds of parents and the lives of them, that they're curating their children's experience even as they move through their teenage years to a degree that's probably unhelpful. Because again, it's this transition from the dependence to the independence. And so it's the perfect time for parents to start to ease off and start to give a little bit more of those freedoms, and indeed the opportunities to make those decisions, and the space for the young adults. Keep in mind that the parenting role extends a lot later now. These teenagers, these Gen Alphas, will stay in the parental home a lot later, probably closer to their mid-20s, because they're going to be in education later. They're going to therefore earn a little later in life. They're going to marry later and start their own families later. And so they're actually going to be in the home and in the parents' lives for a lot longer, and therefore important to get the patterns right of easing off on that micromanaging input, not leaning back. We still got to lean forward as parents. Even as they're in the 20s, we want to be parents that lean in to the lives of our kids, but we want to lean in but keep the hands out, you know, and allow them to make decisions. Maybe we ask more questions, we give a bit of guidance, but not jump in and rescue the situation. I've had principals, when we do some of our school engagement work, say to me, you know, they despair now at parents who are jumping in at any issue, even in the high school years, trying to solve it, texting other parents that might have been involved in that situation, you know, trying to solve the problem themselves rather than letting the children do so, or indeed the schools manage it. And often these principals will say the parents will pull the child out of the school. There's been an issue. There's been a relational challenge. There's been a blow up in the friendship network or whatever, or maybe a negative interaction with a staff member, and the parents say, "That's it. I'm withdrawing the enrollment here. I'm going to try a different school." And some of these poor teens have been enrolled in 3 or 4 or 5 different schools. The parents are bringing a consumer mindset, thinking that money and the decision alone can solve the problem. And the poor youngster in the midst of all of this is having to uproot that social network, re-engage in this one. It's already a very awkward social life stage, and now they're being moved from school to school. And that was the advice of one of these experienced principals. He said, rule number one, don't withdraw your child just because there's been an issue. There might be a time with ongoing issues, you've exhausted every avenue and you just can't solve it. Okay, let's not take it off the table. But the idea, even when there's been pretty big issues for the child, to withdraw them, all we're going to do is swap one set of challenges at that school for another set of challenges at the new school. There is no perfect school. It's just the nature of teenage years, and we end up with creating problems if that's our go-to parenting style. I think we almost need to think like a director, not a manager. You know, we know in the work we do, actually, you know, managers, they get in, they solve all the problems. They get in, they sort it, they tell the team how to do it, what to do. Directors sit back and they can't get hands in to the organization they're directing. They ask questions, they assess things, they check, they probe, but they lean in, but they keep their hands out. And I think particularly as the teen years progress and the parents are now parenting mid-teens, certainly later teens, lean in but hands out is probably a good way to go.
I think that's such great advice. And it reminds me of, again, like advice that we've given to leaders in the workplace that we've also given to parents of Generation Alpha, like the 3 E's that we put in the book around sort of helping to develop the people that you are entrusted with, which is number one, to encourage, number two, to equip, and number three, to entrust. And that idea that like you don't want to just fully go hands off and not care, obviously we're not saying that, but they still need encouragement and they still need advice and guidance, but maybe that more, that last bit with entrusting them with opportunities to step out as they do reach that new life stage. So I think that's really great advice, really sage advice, Mark, there from you. And I imagine a lot of parents as well today are maybe starting to think about their child's future, if they're not already, as they start to hit those teenagers, they go, okay, they're a teenager, they're starting, that means they're in senior school or high school. That's a massive shift as well from primary school, where everything is sort of looked after. Like I remember for me, like the first day of year 7, I couldn't find like the science classroom, and that was just me trying to find it like on my own, and I was late and it was embarrassing. But it was that whole like, okay, this is a whole new ball game now. We're not in primary school anymore. And I imagine even part of that is thinking about their future careers as they start to navigate subjects and do different ways of learning and school, to, I guess, eventually work out what sort of career pathway they will take. Oftentimes we're asked by careers advisors to speak at conferences about the future of work because we operate in that futurist space. What sort of jobs do you think this generation might work in, and what sort of skills do you think they will require as a result?
Well, they'll work in more jobs than we've seen in the past. They'll have more careers. They'll move through more education. They will be those lifelong learners. So it's going to be a far more dynamic employment future for them. As we found in our study of this age group, that about 4 in 5 of them will be self-employed at some point. Maybe it's the side hustle, you know, maybe it's gig economy stuff while they're an employee, but they'll certainly be managing things a bit more themselves. And so that needs a whole new set of skills from what we've had in the past. Yes, they're going to need the academic training, and the literacy and the numeracy and the academic development is important, but they'll be in education a lot longer. I think beyond that, we want to make sure they're being holistically developed. So are they developing competencies along with that curriculum knowledge? In other words, the transferable skills, the ability to relate well to people, to resolve conflict, to show leadership, to communicate effectively, the character formation we discussed, you know, resilience and decision making and care for others and being culturally aware, being able to bridge gaps. The workplace is going to be more diverse, their communities more diverse. They'll be leading people. Some are in the room, some are remote. So they'll need the ability to connect across all of that. So it's the transferable skills, the people skills, the life skills the character stuff, as well as the academic skills that are going to be so important. And much of that isn't learned in a classroom. You know, it's learned through volunteering, through having a job, through sports and team activities, through serving others, and through learning from parents and varied experiences. So you know, it's great that we've got such a developed school system, and that people have the chance of getting after school tutoring and subject coaching. All of that's excellent, but we wouldn't want to be one dimensional where they're A plus academically, but C minus on the people side or on the life skills side. You know, that development of the whole child is important, morally, spiritually, socially, culturally, and of course, academically. All of that matters to ensure they'll thrive. Because if all they're doing is picking up some coding skills, I mean, that's great. You know, it is a digital future. The ability to code or to do desktop design, I'm sure that'll come in handy. But also, you know, maybe the technology will change and it's going to be a bit more intuitive, and you won't need that coding language. You won't need that massive investment in that particular, you know, nuanced tech skill. But those broader skills are going to be important. So I would say to parents, do what you know is important. You know, that intuitive parenting where you say, you know, they're going to need these broader approaches to life. They're going to need some more experience. They're going to need to be a little bit traveled and get some experience in these different situations and contexts, sometimes out of our comfort zones as we bring them along with us, as we volunteer or go on that overseas trip or push them into signing up to this program. But you know what, that's going to develop them holistically. And in an uncertain future with more change to come, it's that holistic development, those multiple skills that are going to serve them well into their long future.
Yeah, I think it really is beneficial for us all to not just get super laser focused. And a good kind of, not warning, that sounds a little bit negative, but something to be aware of even as this generation now start to approach those adulthood years, to help us help them not be too focused and not too much pressure on, like you said, the academics, which I feel like we have seen a bit in recent years with Generation Z, the generation above them, and just be so your ATAR is so important and the pressure they face versus that more holistic approach. Because even, like you said, even in the future of work, which will be aided more by robotics, we don't just need people or kids who can code. We need, holistic people who are able to contribute beyond that. So really great chat today, Mark. Very big topic as we think about encouraging parents to help this generation transition into that next sort of life stage, the oldest of them anyway. So important always for parents, but I think also, for organizations to be thinking about this future generation who, again, might not be entering even in our workplaces for a number of years, but it'll happen before we know it. So thanks for the chat today, Mark. Always great to have you on the podcast.
I enjoyed it. Thanks, Ash.
And if you would like to stay up to date with McCrindle's latest insights, you can subscribe to the podcast. You can follow us on social media, or you can head to McCrindle.com or GenerationAlpha.com, where we've got a bit more of a focus just on Generation Alpha there. So as always, thanks again for listening, and bye for now.